being here again, and we'll move on into our next segment here. Liza, if you could introduce our guest speaker, I'd appreciate that.
Yeah, we have a number of strategic alliances, and we've been bringing them in on our monthly calls and found it's been really informative and helpful because, you know, our ultimate goal is to work directly with them, both at the national level, but at the coast level. Todd Mann is here with us. He's the executive director of the National Consortium of Secondary STEM Schools. We've had an MOU with NCSSS since June of 2018, so we're looking at 2 years. The ultimate goal of that MOU is, you know, for our two associations to facilitate collaboration and information sharing, enhance the personal development, leadership, and career opportunities in STEM fields for children and young adults. One of the things that we have done to try and facilitate this, which we'll be publishing at some point, is establish a map that shows our post and the NCSSS school. So Todd's going to tell us a little bit more about NCSSS, and welcome. Thank you.
Thank you, Liza. I appreciate the introduction. Jeff, Eddie, thank you for the invitation. It's great to be here and great to be with our partner of 2 years, and we look forward to many more years. I consider this as just the infancy stages of our partnership, that we both have a lot of learnings to do about our organizations and how we can work together and benefit each other's memberships. And in particular, with this community of interest, obviously it's right up our alley and at NCSSS. So what I'd like to do in these few minutes is just to get you a little bit better acquainted with the organization, the makeup of our member schools, and tell you a little bit about where we are, and then open it up to some questions, certainly, if you have any. But the goal is to see how can we be connecting, not just at the national level, because I think we're doing a good job of getting that together, but more importantly, what can we start doing at the post-to-school level? That's really where the fun happens and where everything really materializes. So let me tell you a little bit about NCSSS. The organization is just about 32, 33 years old. I may be a little bit out of sequence, Eddie and Liza, on my slides, if that's okay, but I think we're fine. We're about a little bit over 30 years old, and it was started by schools that were doing STEM before STEM was STEM, really. Schools like Bronx Science, Brooklyn Tech in New York City, Illinois Math Science in Chicago, Louisiana School of Math, Science, and the Arts in outside of New Orleans, North Carolina School of Math and Science. These were all schools that started up and said, well, let's connect together and help each other develop a true STEM curriculum. So that outside of the ordinary, let's just have math and science classes, what does it mean to be authentically STEM? So as a part of that, they started reaching out to other schools and helping mentor those schools as they wanted to become more authentically STEM. And really what we meant by authentically STEM is that it's both a curriculum that permeates everything, including into the humanities. We do teach humanities at these schools, but the thought process, the critical thinking, gets applied in everything we do throughout. So that's really what's at its core. So the organization started out, as I said, a little bit over 30 years ago, and bit by bit, it started growing. And part of the growth got spurred by the charter members saying, meeting with other schools, mentoring, coaching, and helping grow those schools into pure STEM high schools. Now today, the membership is relatively small, but we pride ourselves on that because the goal is to make sure that if a school wants to apply to be a member, they have to actually apply. They have to provide documentation that, in fact, they are truly a STEM school. So what we don't want to do is we don't want any school to just say, well, let's put a microscope in a classroom, call it a science lab, and then hang out our STEM shingle. What we want to do is enable students, high school students, middle school students, and their parents as they explore schools to look at, to know that this is truly a STEM school, and to have that be a curriculum. So we have a board committee that evaluates member applications and then makes a decision that they're now purely STEM, or they may be on the way to getting there. We'll give them a more of an associate status membership and then work with them to get there. So the organization has grown. We have been pretty much volunteer run until I came on board in 2013. And when I looked at what we had, I thought, wow, this is, these are the people who are doing it, living it every day. I thought that they were like the best kept secret in town. But in DC, you don't want to be the best kept secret. You want everybody to know about you. So we kind of embarked on an awareness campaign, both on the Hill, agencies, lots of other constituencies. And I would say that the kind of milestone of when we knew we had arrived, quote unquote, was when Congress came to us when they were writing the ESSA legislation, the Every Student Succeeds Act, and came to us and said, hey, would you give us a definition of a true STEM school? And that's now, our definition is now embedded into the law. But for us, it just meant that we were starting to get the awareness of the resource that we could offer. So we've kind of taken advantage of that awareness level and started reaching out to all kinds of constituencies and letting us know, how can we work together? What can we do to partner to make it easier and more informative for students who want to go into down into the STEM field, be it science, technology, engineering, math, and related fields, and contribute to society on that basis. So, I think at that point, a couple of years ago, is when we first bumped into Eddie and the leadership and started our conversations that way. And we look at same as giving us an opportunity to branch out even further, to create that connection and really further the field, both to the benefit of the military engineers, as well as to do everything we can within the students of our member schools and say, hey, there's a great career path for you. There are many opportunities out there, but we want you to be aware of this career path and the ability to really contribute to our country. So that's pretty much what we do. We're connected with all kinds of corporations, different schools. A lot of universities are connected with us now. Obviously, as you might expect, they want to kind of get their talents into these high performing kids. And as I said, we're with policymakers a lot. We also now connect internationally, but here you see pretty much the states that we're concentrated in. I'd say we're pretty good on the eastern half of the country. We have a lot more work to do in the western half of the country, so a lot of our focus is there. We held our annual conference last year, and I think folks from SANE were there in Washington State and Seattle, and we were going to have a conference in person this year, but obviously, like many folks, we're going to be virtual. So I'd love to just kind of stop there and talk to you a little bit and see what are the ways, first, do you have any questions in general about the makeup of the organization? And then secondly, are there any things that you think we can be doing to help connect with you and your posts?
Todd, thanks very much. A couple things come to mind. One, if the conference is going to be virtual this year, how do I get an invite? Or can I attend? Let me put it that way.
People, okay? You just got to have some influence here, but we will send you and certainly to Eddie, we'll send the registration. We're opening up next week to registration. Obviously, it's always a big pivot, as you guys know, to go from in person to just, it's not, you're not just flipping a switch to suddenly go virtual. So we had a delay for a month while we explored platforms, but we'll get that to you folks for distribution.
That would be great. And I think it's really cool that the government pretty much said, hey, you tell us the definition of what a STEM school is. I agree with you. You've kind of know you've arrived when you reach that level. So that's very cool to hear. Does anyone else have any questions right now? I'm looking at the map that's up right now, and are the pins indicating schools or offices?
Those are states in which we have at least one or more schools. So we have a lot of schools in Texas, Florida, Missouri. So we have more than the pins, but we don't, for example, have any schools in Oregon or Nevada or Arizona or New Mexico, for example.
Now, and is that a case the fact of...
Go ahead, Jeff, sorry.
Oh, I'm sorry, no, go ahead, Eddie.
I think we were going to ask a separate question. This is because this is where you have partnerships with schools, not because there aren't schools in those other states.
These are schools that are members of NCSSS. Yes.
Right. So for a post that might be. Go ahead, Jeff.
No, you're good.
for the state, for the posts that are in the states that don't have one, they could get some look at your website on guidance on how they work with some of these schools and offer to be, to work with local schools they have in a similar capacity, even if they're not part of your network.
Absolutely.
You do want posts to be looking at the STEM schools that are in their backyard. You're just Absolutely. One example of one network that exists.
Absolutely. I mean, first of all, even though you have to apply to be a member, we're not an exclusive organization. So there are lots of ways for us to get partnered. And if you have questions about any specific schools in the state, you can reach out to me and I'll make sure you get connected up with schools in the state if they are members and vice versa. If you want to alert us to schools that you folks are partnered with that you'd like to have involved somehow in the organization, please let us know. It needs to work both ways. Did that answer your question?
So two questions. Yes.
Okay.
But it leads to two more questions. One, to be a member of your organization, do they have to identify themselves and focus on STEM, or would what I'll call a normal school system who just has a really great science and technology program be able to join as a member?
The answer is yes, they can. The majority of our schools now are traditional high schools that have strong, I mean, what we look for really is our schools that have research, have research as a part of their curriculum, where they ask students to be able to do research, have some science, have some, good math programs. But the majority of our schools now are not, you wouldn't say, they have public high school list, that's their identifier.
Okay, because here, I'm in Ohio, I noticed there's no pin in Ohio. And yet we have a school next door to Wright-Patterson Air Force Base here, that very strong STEM program, and we deal a lot with them. We bring them on base for field trips and do things. And we also have, where we're expanding our reach now, the Dayton Regional STEM School. And so getting some information about the criteria for joining. If you guys have a brochure, I assume there's some stuff in the slides here about the benefits and stuff, and that we could help facilitate that contact.
So what I'll do is I wasn't sure how many slides to put on there. I didn't want to have this be a session of death by slides. So what I'll do is we'll forward over some basic information about the benefits of that, and I'll send it to Eddie, and Eddie can then distribute it to each of you. That'll work.
Yeah, we'll send that out to the entire community of interest when we tell them that we've posted the recording online, and here's some literature to go with it. That'd be great.
Right.
Does anyone else have any questions?
Yeah, Mike Langley with the Denver chapter. What is the website that I could access to look up these lists? What I'm looking for, frankly, is I'm head of the scholarship here, and we've greatly expanded over the last couple of years. Primarily, when we go out, almost all the solicitations are from kids already in college. We have opportunities for kids, junior ROTC, or if nominated by one of our members, for a high school senior to get it. But if I could get this list, I'd like to talk with my chapter that we could try and target these schools early on in our cycle for scholarships.
Sure. So first of all, could you advance to my last slide set, which has my email address on it? But
if you could tell me that, I'm just on the phone. I'm not.
Okay. So the website is ncsss.org, ncsss.org. And for my email, it would be todd.mann@ncsss.org, todd.mann@ncsss.org.
ncsss.org. Thank you very, very much.
Sure. I would look forward to hearing from you.
Can I ask one question?
Sure.
Can you guys hear me?
Yes.
Can you guys hear me? I'm involved in the Future City Competition in New York, which is a middle school program. Do you have a lot of schools in your organization that are involved with that program also?
Not as many middle schools, but I don't know how many schools are involved with that program. We do, you know, we're pretty strong in New York City, as you might expect, but I don't know the extent to which we have schools that are involved in that program, but it's always easy for us to find out. So if you wanted to pop me a note with that question, I'll find out for you and get back to you.
I know that the national organization partners with several STEM programs, so I just was wondering if you're one of them.
I'm not sure that we are, but I'd love to talk to, you know, love talking to other organizations.
Okay.
So that'd be great.
Anybody actually might be a question.
Go ahead, Jeff.
Sorry. I was going to say that last question might actually be one for Liza, as far as strategic alliances and national partnerships and whatnot. Liza, I'm going to let you take.
Yeah, so I was going to mention that, you know, we have most of all of our strategic alliances on our national website. And then we also have additional details about the strategic partners that we've had on our monthly calls on our COI website for the K-12 STEM outreach. And the GIS map that we're putting together will ultimately end up linked from that page as well. So that would really help with the post being able to identify, you know, when they have schools that are close by, you know, so we can get down to the grassroots part of, you know, our MOU. So thank you very much, Todd. This is very informative.
Okay, great.
Yeah, if we could, the Future City has regions all around the country, like 39 of them. I'm from the New York Post, and the engineers work with the students, so.
Okay. All right, great. Well, listen, thank you again for having me. Great to be with all of you, and I look forward to having this grow even further. So thank you very much. And I'll be getting information to Eddie and then on to Jeff.
Okay, sounds great.
Thanks so much. Appreciate it.
Yeah. You bet. Thank you. Bye-bye.
All right. Liza, was there anything else you needed to wrap up there from NCSSS, or are we on to our next presentation here?
I think we're on to construction camps. Here we go.
Okay. Eddie, if you'll kind of explain what we're doing here with our virtual engineering and construction camps. I appreciate it.
Sure. Thank you, Jeff. I think I updated everyone last time that we had to cancel this summer season because of the virus. But we, over the last month, have had some great conversations with the U.S. Naval Academy on organizing a virtual, and actually it's really more just a virtual STEM camp. It's not meant to be a replacement for the engineering and construction, but really an opportunity to offer some activity that our students could still participate in this summer. It's a week long, Monday through Friday. All our campers that were selected for our camp season were invited to participate. There was no fee for this. The camp is being supported by a network of posts that have contributed monies that they would have put towards sponsoring a student to the engineering and construction camps are now being repurposed to support the virtual camp. It's going to be our first time doing something like this, and some of this connects back to the topic we talked about last month about virtual activities and the new reality of the fact that we're all going to need to be creative of how to do STEM engagement when we're not going to be potentially convening students in person anymore. So this camp is going to be a good test for us to see what a coordinated week-long curriculum of virtual activities looks like. There is a mentoring component that they've worked in. So some of our camp mentors that we're going to mentor at our ENC camps have now volunteered to be a mentor at the virtual camp. But again, this is the first time we've done something like this. If all goes well, we have already started talking about having a permanent virtual camp next year. We've been trying to figure out a way to really expand the number of students that we can reach. And it would be great for the K-12 STEM outreach work that the posts are doing to have not just the physical camps to point campers students to, but a virtual camp that really anybody would be able to, or at least a lot more people would be able to participate than those that can have the time and money to do one of the physical camps. So we're looking forward to seeing how it goes, and I think the crossover then with this COI is this collection of virtual activities could then be replicated by any number of posts that want to put together their own, say, spring break virtual activity or add to the summer options that are going on next summer. So more to come. We'll have our AAR, and then I'll be able to report back to this group how everything went.
Great. I appreciate that. I do have a question. With it being virtual, and not having a single or two mentor, one or two mentors in charge of a squad of folks like mm-hmm. they do at the engineering construction camps, are they looking for more mentors because of the virtual nature of it? Is it more of a one-on-one mentorship? Do you know? And is that a possibility for some of our K-12 folks here who wouldn't necessarily be a mentor in person, but would love to be a virtual mentor?
Yes, there could still be the training was supposed to be slated for this week for all the mentors. I think we just went out to the mentors that had already been recruited. It isn't meant to be one-on-one. I think it actually became more of a challenge to recruit for a virtual mentoring opportunity because we're not really sure what the schedule is going to look like. So the mentors are being asked to block out an entire week and not know what their actual assignments are going to be until we get closer to the camp. But they ended up punting the training to next week. I could see if they're still looking for mentors. I think our last count, we had 18 already signed up, and we had about 150 campers. So they're trying to get about two mentors per camp, per group. and each group is going to be anywhere from 10 to 15 students per group. So it isn't meant to be one-on-one. They're going to go into Google Hangout rooms and where the mentors will be available to answer questions, you know, offer guidance, discuss some of the activities. But again, until we see it done, I don't really know how it's all going to work. So we didn't make a big push because we didn't want a lot of folks dropping what they were doing and not, you know, until we knew exactly what was all going to be involved in this. But if anybody is interested,
right,
send me a note and I can add you to, you know, see if we can add you to the mentor list.
That'd be great. That'd be great. I wasn't sure how many they were, if they were going to need a lot more because it was virtual. And certainly if this grows in future years, maybe there will be. I think the after action report is going to be key because I think the new normal when everything all settles out in a steady state, speaking like an engineer here, is there's going to be a lot of virtual events that are going to take place from now on. So that'd be great. Looking forward to that.
Sure.
Any other questions about the virtual camps? Okay. Next slide. Okay, so as I mentioned in the opening remarks, we're entering our second year of the K-12 STEM Outreach Community of Interest. And we put together a work plan last year. Gonna run over this real quick. I don't wanna spend a lot of time on it, but we have a leadership team with liaisons to other COIs, also looking for folks that maybe wanna be on this leadership team. Don't necessarily want to be a liaison. If we have someone who's good at web stuff, if we have someone who's good at writing and wants to help with the TME article, kind of pulling that together each time, those would be great. If you've got a skill, if you'd like to just help kind of steer where we're going, we'd love to have you on the committee. We're always looking to update and keep our webpage and our SharePoint site growing with best practices, with events that are going on, with how-tos, those kind of things. And there's a push at the national level to try to organize all of the community of interest's web pages similarly, so when someone goes in, they know where to find stuff. So could use someone to kind of go in and take over organizing that for me. One of the items on our work plan was to hold these monthly telecons. They've been going very well. Liza's been getting us some great partners to help present a lot of good information there. And number four there is featuring one of our strategic alliances. So we want to continue doing that. But as we get down the road, as we go through and use a lot of our strategic alliances, we don't have to feature an organization that is already a strategic alliance. It could be someone that we want to investigate or something that our membership wants to learn more about. We could even bring in one of the other community of interest and see what kind of overlap and synergy there is. Maybe the architectural practice comes in and talks about how to STEM outreach architecture. I don't know, I'm throwing ideas out here, but always looking for more ways to make these calls more meaningful. Number five on our work plan last year, the first five are from last year with just some minor updates for this year. Number five was to increase the number of posts who have an identified STEM POC. And we wanna make sure we increased that last year. We want to increase that again this year. We want to try to get these folks and get them on a call and get this information out to them. We added a sixth item to the work plan this year, and that is to update our charter, which is only a year old, but we want to add some language in there to make sure that we are aligning with the new five-year strategic plan that the National has since we have a new strategic plan. And I'm sure that there is somebody out there who is a much better wordsmith than me. I'm an engineer. I'm good with numbers. And if someone wants to help me write that paragraph for our charter, I will be forever grateful.
Hey, Jeff.
Next slide, please.
This is Neil. I got a quick question for you.
Hi, Neil.
Hi. Eddie and I were having a conversation earlier this morning. In fact, my first of many teleconferences of the day. And Heather Wizard Smith, as our new president, has asked us to undertake a couple of strategic reviews. And one of those is going to be about the COIs. And since I'm kind of the vice president overlooking seven COIs, part of my response back to Buddy Barnes, who's going to run it, was that the things you talked about of where can we see kind of the overlap, I keep referring this week to the Venn diagram overlap of our different COIs, and we're going to do a pretty deep dive in that. So we're going to come back to you and whoever else you want to choose from the team here, and probably have some fairly detailed conversations about where you're going, what you're trying to do, and where you see overlap. So the things that you've identified here on your update, I really appreciate, and just understand we'll be coming back to you to dive much deeper. Okay, thanks.
Hey, thanks, Neil. I appreciate that.
I also had one thing to add on this slide. We're also trying to make it easier or more efficient for when POCs get established. If those POCs relate to one of the COIs, that they're automatically added to the COI roster, so that we can make sure that the right people in leadership positions at the post level are getting the right information. And I think over the last couple of days, I've been working with our database folks to move all the identified STEM POCs into the COI, and then when we get the change of officer forms, that'll be our ongoing maintenance of making sure the COI is current.
So you say we're gonna increase our number of POCs automatically almost, right? No, it's done deal.
On this, yes, but then now—
That's fine, I appreciate that.
The challenge now becomes communicating.
Go after the ones that don't have one identified.
Right, and then making sure we keep the current ones engaged and aware of what's going on.
Yep. Right. So in addition to this call, we want to try to make sure we keep those folks engaged. So now what I'd like to hear is from any posts that are out there on the call here about anything that you guys have done. I realize with quarantine and social distancing and stuff, there may not have been quite as much outreach going on as we normally would do, but has anyone got anything they'd like to share with the group about what their post is doing STEM outreach wise?
I can share. Can you hear me?
Yes, Vivian, go ahead.
Okay. I'm Vivian Gu from the Oxnard Ventura Post, and I'm the coordinator for our STEM program. What we did is we have a group now dedicated to STEM, and we broke up the K-12 and college. We also do college. So we have one person in charge of K-6, 7-8. We actually were in charge in 2019 of the 7-8 STEM for girls, but we added the boys this year and had 400 participants. And our member was the chair. And I've been to those, I was a structural engineer, so you teach them basics. And then 9-12, we do the science fairs. But this year, I already started something with the NJROTC. We also support the Navy ROTC program because the Wainimi High School is across the street from the Navy base. And that's how we got started about 40 years ago. Actually, we're trying to be productive too. Like, we brought in Cisco for the school and started a vocational training for hardware. And the kids were making so much money, they didn't want to go to college. But anyway, as it turned out, the 9-12 is working out well. We used to have the Academy of engineers there for the whole county, but somehow they rotated that with another school. So Wainimi High School is now the robotics type of engineering. And what I have taken on my own, because I was disappointed last year, I didn't get any volunteers, although everybody said they were going to do it from the university there. We have a computer science mechatronics engineering group, which I am one of the advisors. And I asked, hey, guys, you want to help me? I need to do a sea perch, you know, doing the sea perch with the little robots going under ocean. And everybody said, yeah. And then it was time to do it. And somehow nobody wanted to take the time to go to mentor at the school. So I'm going to start that this year. I might have to go to NAFC for help rather than where I was going. And the one that really, I don't know if you guys heard about the National Contest and Cyber Patriots. Have you heard of them? The Cyber Patriots are people who in high school are learning to be the people who attack us. They try to, you have to know 5 different software programs. And we got everybody, we got our coach, who's a military guy, he's in charge of the NJROTC program. And I was trying to get a mentor, you know, to tell them, hey, you do this. And, you know, they go through county level, state level, and then national level. It's like the spelling bee, except there, a lot of them go to mechatronics when they're done with NJROTC, besides going to the ROTC programs. And all engineers, everything we do is centered on math, science, and engineering. And that's what we've been doing for, I guess, probably 5 years now. And that is the thing that's different. We're trying to also mentor the kids that are competing in national contests. And these kids at Wainimi High are your underprivileged kids. Most of them have to work after school to help support the family. So that's why I put so much effort on my part. And I treat them to speakers. When we have a speaker at a luncheon, I'll get a table and top 5 kids go there, 10 kids. And we listen about cyber attacks and cyber, you know, security. So that's where we are. And in the college level, I go out and I speak to the various colleges. We have junior colleges, 3 of them, and we have the University of California, Channel Islands, which is located in Camarillo. And we had one of the 3 only mechatronics program. You heard of mechatronics, right? Mechatronics program. Where they learn to do artificial intelligence. And this is the 3rd year now, they just started the school. So I meet with them and with the people who have industries, the people that owns the companies, you know, the big companies that want the kids to work for them. There's a program we have, like a memorandum of understanding between the university and that base gets involved too. And the kids get to learn and apply and help develop artificial intelligence. And when they do, they get a job. Normally it's with that company. So that's where we are. And we're doing good. We're very, and we participate in Engineering Week every year with Santa Barbara and Oxnard Ventura in that area. So that's what we're doing. We're a very small club. We're just a small club, but we're interested in these areas. So we do it. And I carry back everything you say to the club. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
Oh, well, thanks, Vivian. Well, certainly Oxnard Ventura is a very strong STEM post. I think last month when I was not available to be on the call, I think you guys, we recognized you for your Post Excellence Award, and it's obvious why you guys deserve that. So thanks so much for your report. Is there any other posts out there that have something they'd like to present to the group here? So I think Vivian certainly talked about a number of different things that you can consider and get with. I know our Kitty Hawk post is working very much with the ROTC detachments at several universities and using that as our foot in the door to start a student chapter. And we go and for instance, at the local ROTC, they have a kind of a career day, and they talk about the different fields that the ROTC guys can go in. And being an Air Force ROTC, we go and talk about civil engineering detachment and the fact that it's not just civil engineers, it's all the disciplines that, you know, own and operate and run the base. And so our post provides people to go and talk about what being a civil engineer in the Air Force is all about. If there's no one else that has anything to talk about, we'll go on to our next slide because we are running a little short on time here. Is there someone else? Go ahead.
I could tell you a little bit about New York Post. I mean, I'm not the lead of the STEM, but I can just give you a quick update. You know, we have several scholarships we give out every year for engineering students. That's one of our main events for the year. We also do that Math Counts program for over 20 years now. And some people are involved in the Future City and mentoring teams for that. And we also work with West Point a lot for different programs they have there. Those are our main activities in New York.
That's great. I appreciate that. And yeah, I wasn't familiar with Future City until a few months ago. And that just sounds like a really cool thing, especially at the middle school level. So that's great. Eddie, let's move on to the next slide, unless someone else has a real urgent matter here. Okay, so our next STEM Corner article is due to the editor on July 15. We got three or four weeks to a few weeks to pull that together, and I'm looking for ideas for the article. Vivian helped a lot a couple of months back with the history of STEM outreach. We pulled. We had a lot of folks donate material for that. We've talked about. We've used some of the award write-ups from the winning Post Excellence STEM Outreach Post Excellence Awards for our last article. And so I'm looking for ideas. We typically do not feature a single post unless it's a really spectacular thing that they've done, but if we have two or three posts and we can feature STEM events or activities that they've done, or always looking for something with images, something with that will be good information for all the posts to read about ideas that they might try or could do. So does anyone have any thoughts they want to throw out right now about what we might publish in our next STEM Corner article? Don't be shy, speak right up. This is a community of interest, so could use a little more community help here. If you think of something, if your post is doing something, if you're putting on a day camp, if you're assisting with a STEM evening, a STEM event, or if you've got, please let me know. Please contact me. We're looking for ideas for this next article.
Jeff?
Yes.
Is the the virtual STEM camp, is that already being discussed in the TME anywhere? Is that something that could be part of the STEM Corn article?
Probably.
The camp is actually going to take place after this article is due, but the article is not going to come out until after the camp. So my thought is once we get the after action report, we might summarize what happened, and it might be an idea for a post to use, but it's probably not this next one. It's the one after. Am I off on my timing, Eddie?
It depends on how whether they can hold this deadline for us. I did put a note out to Daniel Wheatley, who works with Stephen Carl, to find out what their drop dead is. So we may be able to use this as the camps article. I can follow up with you, Jeff. But either way, you know, the next one then would be a September timeframe. So that would give us maybe another month or two to come up with another idea if CAMPS does work.
I wanted to add Captain Langerquist, who is our president. He's the number two on the base for Naval Base. He is deeply involved with the Navy one in Annapolis. Do you want me to ask him if he wants to highlight something?
Well, we're working directly with Naval Academy on the camp. So, you know, whatever information we would get, you know, from their data.
Yeah, so, more so you are there. Because I know their work,
but
that's all I know.
Yeah, he's very active when we would do the physical one at Fort Hueneme.
Right.
So, and I think now that everything's shifted to Naval Academy, we're working through their STEM center. The Naval Academy has a separate STEM center that gets funding to do various different STEM outreach activities. But yeah, Jeff, so, you know, I can coordinate with you to see if the CAMPS one will make a good one for this one, and maybe we punt an idea for the September deadline.
I was just looking at the timing. If this was due on the 15th, I didn't think we could wait. It wasn't going to do any good to advertise the camp because it will already have happened before the magazine comes out. I didn't know if they could hold it long enough for us to write up what happened, and it'd be very cool to feature this hot off the press. We just had this camp. So if we can do that, let me know. And otherwise, everybody out there, think of things that we want to publish in our STEM corner, because we either want to use it in September or we're going to need it here if they can't hold that. So please let me know what your posts are doing if you've got some great activity in it. It could even be more of a how-to article or how to make contact or how to get your foot in the door with a school or those type of things. How to work with the Boy Scouts or support their summer camp program, whatever. If you've got an idea, if there's something your post is doing, please let me know. We don't publish a newsletter. Some of the other community of interest put out like a quarterly or a couple times a year newsletter. I view this STEM Corner article as our newsletter to let all the posts know what we as a community of interest are doing and providing information and ideas to them. So please feed me stuff that you guys are doing that we want to share with the world. We've just got a few minutes left here. What's our next slide? Okay, items to consider for the next call. Liza's always finding us a great strategic alliance to feature. But if you know of one, if your post is working with one, there are several levels of these strategic alliances. There's the ones that Liza is working at the STEM community of interest level. There are national partnerships. I may not be using the exact right term here, that maybe those organizations we work with have a STEM component that we may want to feature. But we also have local posts. I think Todd out at Pikes Peak has some great things that he's doing. Vivian certainly talked about some folks she's working well with. And if that's something that is happening at a local post level that we want to bring in and feature here, that other posts might be able to take advantage of, whether there's any kind of national level partnership isn't necessary. So if you've got a good organization that you think we should feature on these monthly calls, please let us know. And if you've got a best practice you want to talk about, and feature how to do virtual this or how to do a classroom or whatnot, we want to make these calls as useful as possible. Does anyone have any suggestions right now, or you want to think about it and shoot me an email?
I'll think about it.
I think we've got one more slide. Is there anything that when we say community of interest, it's not a committee anymore, it's a community of interest, and it's all of the folks in the posts, their points of contact. What is it that we as a group can do to support each other? What does your post need? Do you need information? Do you need supplies? I don't know what we can do, but we can't figure it out until you ask us. So are there things that posts need right off, or questions that they have that they want to talk about? We're running out of time today, but again, if you think about those, we can feature them in future calls. Is there anything that's urgent right now and anyone needs?
Well, this is Dick Kohanek from San Antonio.
Hey, Dick.
One thing I suggested to Joshua was that I think it would be helpful. A lot of us are doing career days at high school, elementary schools, colleges. It might be good if we had some canned briefings in the post-resource center. You know, that people don't have to use them exactly. They can read it, but, you know, like what an engineer does or an architect does when they're going to an elementary school or a middle school or a high school and even college. The kind of information to put across. And if we could develop
that's a great
a package and put it in the post resource, and I think it'd be helpful to all posts.
That's great. That's exactly the kind of thing I'm looking for. And as we upgrade our website and have a post resources thing and have some canned presentations, whether it's slides, whether it's a Word document, whether it's key things to feature, maybe there's a hands-on demo that your post has done. If you've got a great best practice, whether it's a classroom demonstration or one for one of these evening STEM fairs, or like you said, descriptions and things for keynote presentations or career days, that'd be great. So yeah, I'll make a note of that, and we'll see if we can start working on something like that.
And the same thing goes for you know, we're all doing these demonstrations at STEM days or career or STEM fest or science opportunities. Maybe some of the exhibits, the kinds of exhibits or experiments have proven very successful or students are very receptive to. Like I know we at a STEM fest, we did the exploding volcano, and it was great, the young kids in elementary. And then when we did the Design Treasures events, we did a Lego project management construction thing. But there might be other ideas that have proven successful. I know there's a lot of websites we go to that have lists of hundreds and hundreds of STEM projects. But those that have been kind of proven successful at the post level would be great to put together in a package.
Right. I need someone, and that's my part of my request for some more folks on the leadership team. I need someone who is going to be focused strictly on that part of it, pulling down that information and populating that website. Many hands make light work. Last slide, Eddie, we're out of time here. I appreciate everyone's participation. Thank everyone here for coming. If you have these ideas, please email Eddie and I. We'll share them with the leadership team. If you've got ideas like this, let me know. Happy to have you join our leadership team or executive committee for their community of interest, whatever you want to call us. We have a monthly call to kind of plan this call, but also talk about things that we need to do. And if you're interested in just sitting in on that call without officially being on it, I'm more the merrier, many hands make light work kind of guys. So with that said, you know, we're beginning our second 100 years, and the first year of the K-12 went well, and we're looking to expand and really grow what we're doing here. Thank you all for attending. Eddie, thanks for all you do.
Awesome.
We got to end the call.
Thanks, guys.
Thanks, everyone.
Thanks, everybody.
Thanks.